Okay, Michael, so to demonstrate this idea, or to demonstrate some of these ideas, I'm going to look at grid worlds. One, a very simple grid world to try to get across a pretty straightforward idea, at least what I hope is a pretty straightforward idea, and then a slightly more complicated and prettier grid world in but a moment. But first, let's look at kind of a basic grid world. So this is like our famous 4x3 grid world, except I've added a couple of details. I haven't drawn all the little squares and all the little tiny grids, because really I just sort of want to pop up a level here. But you start somewhere in this world, it almost doesn't matter where, and you have to try to get here to the little plus one. That's where all the reward in the world is. And you have the normal actions. You can move up, down, left, right, and you know, it's slippery, so every once in a while when you try to move up, you end up moving in a perpendicular direction, and the usual sort of thing that we normally do. Now, other than that, what's different about this world is that I've got walls, like we had before, except these walls actually happen to coincidentally create little rooms. So let's imagine that you're starting over here somewhere, and your goal is to eventually learn in this world how to get to, well, this goal. So I think we know how to do this. I think we've done this before many, many times. We certainly did it in the 4x3 grid world. But I want to ask you a slightly different question. I want you to think about this in a slightly different way. If you were trying to tell a person how you should get from this point to this point, what would you tell them?
I'm going to say Google Maps.
This isn't on Google Maps. This is in a GPS dead zone.
What?
Yeah, I know. I know. It's amazing.
Wow. I guess that's one of the real benefits of reinforcement learning, is it can work even in a GPS dead zone. So so the question is, how would you tell them to go? Well, so, you know, we talk to agents via policies. So I could try to give a policy, but you didn't really give, so that's a mapping from states to actions, but you didn't really give me a lot of details about what the states were. So probably if I was talking to a person, I would say something kind of high level, like, well, pass through the doorway to the east, then you enter a room and there's a doorway to the south, go through that, and then a little bit inside the doorway, you'll find a great reward, or at least a reward.
Oh, plus one is the greatest reward that anyone can receive, Michael. You know that. So, right. And I like this because what you did is I gave you the actions up, down, left, right. And you could have said, okay, so move right, 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 down, right, right, and then go, oh, I don't know, right, right, down, 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 right, or something. But instead, you said, well, go to the doorway and then go to the another doorway. And then once you're past that doorway, you know, you'll just take a couple of steps and you'll end up where you want to be, where the great reward is. And that's perfectly reasonable. In fact, it's more than perfectly reasonable. It's a kind of abstraction. In the same way that function approximation is a sort of abstraction over the states, what you just described is what we call temporal abstraction.
Ah, I see.
And, you know, that has a specific meaning, but I think to really kind of grasp what it is, the right way to think about it is you came up with new actions.
That's making the action space bigger.
Making the action space bigger, which is a problem, you would think. But each of these actions actually covers an enormous amount of ground. So in fact, if you had said right, 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 down, right, 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 down, 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 right, or something like that, that's a lot of actions to have to reason over a long period of time. But what you actually said was take one action, take another action, and then, I don't know, take one or two actions. So we managed to do with your new actions in, I don't know, about 5 steps, what would have otherwise taken, 100 steps.
Or maybe, that's a cool idea.
Maybe 60 steps, right. And that is where the abstraction comes from and where the temporal nature comes from. Because again, the one of the things that makes reinforcement learning hard is this delayed reward. And what's implicit in that is that you have to reason over time, that you have to take many, many steps. And because all the option, there are several options at every state, you're actually getting an exponential blow up over all the paths you might take. And here what you've done is you've traded off the price and adding new actions with being able to skip over having to make a bunch of decisions along the way. And so now I can do in 5 steps what would have taken 100 steps, and that's going to be a gigantic exponential savings.